acquisitions are designed to demonstrate forcibly to old and young alike that crime does not pay. The shells from the sinking shotgun boat were blasting the water nearer and nearer the American submarine that had just rammed her. A few seconds more, rain. Commander Howard Gilmore, rushing to follow his men down the hatch, was cut down by Jap machine gun bullets. Badly wounded, he knew the time needed to rescue him, making them lost of his ship. Without a moment's hesitation, he ordered, "Take her down!" And down she went, the submarine to safety, a gallant commander to his death. Keep that picture in your mind, friend. And when you're asked to buy an extra $100 war bond now in the fourth war loan drive, buy it. Put every dollar not needed for absolute necessities into bonds now. Not just because they're sound, profitable investments, but because they'll bring victory sooner. Bring more men home. The Shadow, the serious character who aids the forces of law and order, is in reality Lamont Cranston, wealthy young man about town. Several years ago in the Orient, Cranston learned a strange and mysterious secret. The hypnotic power to cloud men's minds so they cannot see him. Cranston's friend and companion, the lovely Margot Lane, is the only person who knows to whom the voice of the invisible shadow belongs. A path to death. Unluckily, then.
Let me out of this electric chair. No, wait.
Don't touch the switch.
No, don't.
Right on time. Oh,
Mr.
Flyer,
my guests are
in. Come in.
Thanks, Margo. There's me, please, the mothers-in-law can be kept waiting. But the cook? Never. Guys, I'm hungry.
Well, we'll eat in a minute. First, I want you to meet someone.
Hmm?
Not in the living room.
All right,
Peter? Peter, here's the gentleman you've been so anxious to meet.
Is this Mr. Cranston?
Yes. Come on, you remember Alice Cranston,
don't you? Yes.
Well, this is his son, Peter.
Really? Well, hello, Peter. I knew your mother quite well before she moved out.
She still talks a lot about you and Miss Lane.
Oh, is that so?
That's why I've been so anxious to meet you. What mother tells us, Gabby, you're quite something in the field of crime detection.
Well, outside of being a headache to the police commissioner once in a while, Peter, I don't think you could call me more than an interested amateur.
That isn't what the commissioner called you.
Good job, aren't
you? Oh, thanks, Margo. Well, up north on a little vacation, Peter?
Well, no, Mr. Cranston, I'm up here on business. You have to be a part of that business.
I am?
Mm-hmm. He's taking up journalism in college, am I? School set him up to do an article on prison management.
Well, that's interesting.
You want you to help him?
Of course, I'd be only too happy to help you, Peter. Prison management's a bit out of my line.
Well, all he wants is a pass to visit the state prison. I sure didn't it, too, but arrange that for him, Lamont.
Well, I don't want just the usual visitor's pass. I want to write about the whole work, especially the death chamber. Reckon that's about the most interesting place in the prison.
For a budding journalist, I suppose it is. Well, I think you can count on the pass. I'll arrange it as soon as you want to go.
Oh, that's well, Miss Cranston. Thanks a lot. This is going to be a real thriller. I've never been in a death chamber before.
All right, Peter, this is on your head. I don't think you'll find it a pretty place.
Your first visit to the state prison, eh, young man?
Well, this is my first visit to any prison.
I see, and it should be doubly interesting.
Oh, it is. Say, when do we see the death chamber? I especially want to see there.
You'll be in the death chamber soon, huh?
I guess I must seem pretty anxious to you. But you see, I'm studying journalism.
Journalism? Did you say journalism?
Yes, I'm preparing an article for the college paper.
A student of journalism should know who I am. Take a good look at my face. Ever see me in the paper?
No, I can't say that I have.
Never mind, you're young. It was before your time.
Well, I guess you've been working here in the prison a long time. Those stripes on your feet.
Each of those stripes have been sewed on for every 5 years I've served the state.
5 years? Gosh, that's 5, 10, 2.
52 to be exact.
52 years inside prison walls? Connor, doesn't it give you the willies to do me all?
I'm proud of my service. I only wish I could serve again as I have in the past.
But I should
have hold on. Just a minute now.
A
what's this? Step in, please. So it's dark in here.
Yeah, this is the death chamber.
What? The death chamber?
Put on the light.
There we are.
It's nothing to be afraid of.
No, of course not.
Excuse me. Now, here's the room you've been so anxious to see. The last sight on your trip.
See, it's kind of spooky in here.
Spooky? Why, this is one of the best kept rooms of the institution.
And that's the electric tail that
appears. It's not quite as sinister looking as you expected, I suppose.
That depends on the way you look at it. Well, I think of the men that have died in that chair.
Why, my dear boy, death is
nothing.
The most majestic experience of life. Nothing has greater nobility than death.
Yeah, I suppose so. Hey, it's getting warm in here. I guess we better be going, huh?
Going? Why, I haven't told you anything about the death chamber yet.
Oh, I know.
You see that door over there? Well, the pre-execution cells are just beyond. There are 10 men in there now waiting to sit in the seat of the fallen.
Seat of
the electric chair, of course. When they're brought in, the executioner will stand here at this panel, his hand on the switch. The men are strapped in. The warden gives the signal. The switch is thrown in like this. Oh, don't be alarmed. The chair is quite harmless until those wires are plugged in. And they're the electrodes that carry the power through from the powerhouse.
Oh, that's very interesting. Now, I guess I got more material than I need for mine.
Well, see, you wouldn't go without sitting in the chair.
What would I want to do a thing like that for?
Why, every visitor sits in the chair. It's something to tell your friends. Come, sit down.
If you don't mind, I'd rather know.
This is an experience you'll never forget. Hey, let me help you. Sit right down.
Well, it's customary,
of course. There you are. Now I'll show you how it feels to be strapped in.
That's the chest strap.
Well, you certainly did that all the day. Now the right arm. And the left.
Oh, that's enough. You got this chest strap so tight. I can't.
The right leg, like this. And the left.
Well, look, listen. Maybe you didn't hear me, but I said I had enough.
Every drop they hit, he's down like this. And there you are. All snug and ready for the most noble, most majestic experience in life.
What do you mean?
You are now ready for death.
Now look here. Hey, what are you doing with those electrodes? No, no, don't do that. Take your hand on that switch.
Tell us what Ardyce had to say about young Wentworth.
Well, he says the dev house
satisfied by now. You have the word of it.
I'm not satisfied.
Now, look,
I'm grateful to you for what you've done, but I intend to do a little more digging before I'm satisfied.
Oh, Miss Lane. Well, come on in. Make the party complete.
How to make out, Margaret? Did you talk to Peter's mother?
Yes, I just talked to her on the phone.
What did she have to say?
There will be no autopsy.
What?
Peter did have a heart attack.
You don't say. What do you think of that, Cranston?
He was rejected for the Air Force and last month.
Well, that settles it. Now let's go out and have a bite of lunch and pick up some
food. Mr. Lane and I have very personal stake in this case. Peter Wentworth's mother is an old friend of Margot's family, and I gave the boy his path to death.
But hang it all, man. Don't you see?
I see only one thing. Peter Wentworth was murdered.
Now look, I want to straighten you out on one thing. If you think Peter Wentworth was electrocuted in that chair, I can wipe that idea out of your mind right this minute.
How, Chris?
Because there's no power flowing to the electric chair except during a legal execution. When a man is to be executed, the juice has to be turned on in the main powerhouse. Then the electrodes are plugged in near the chair. In other words, the contact has to be made at both ends. Do you get that?
Yes, we get that, Commissioner. Now, you get this. Did you know that a man died in that death table a few weeks ago?
Right.
And under very similar circumstances?
Well, that's news to me.
Right, Commissioner. That'll be news to you, too, when it's proven conclusively that Peter Wentworth was murdered.
Nobody ever did it, neither job, either before or since I was executioner.
No, you don't. don't regret the fact you were redeemed for such a grisly job as that.
It's a fine reward for faithful service.
This letter is a million, so...
They humiliated me by making me guide. But tomorrow...
What about tomorrow?
They're retiring me from the service entirely. But I'll have the last laugh on the whole pack of them.
What are you talking about?
I came to this institution, this state executioner. I leave it as an executioner.
Oh, very interesting. If you just unstrap me now.
Unstrap you? My dear man, you're going to have the honor of dying at the hands of the best executioner the state has ever had. The moment I'm going to attach those electrodes, pull the switch, and fling you into eternity.
You'll die yourself in this chair.
No, I won't. There won't be a mark on you. You die as only Fred Ardach can execute a man, and nobody will ever suspect you haven't died from a heart attack.
Father, I'm sure a fool if you think I'd followed your story.
What do you mean?
Well, I happen to know you can't kill a man unless the electrodes are plugged in on the main power line.
My dear man, they are connected, not to the main power line, but to the old dynamo that was once used for execution. It hasn't been used in years, except for the use I made. Everybody's forgotten it but me. I have
a fear.
I
certainly won't deprive me of my last chance to talk. So you're not only a fiend, Arash, you're a fool as well.
Be quiet.
You'll never get away with it.
I've had enough. I could cover your face with the death metal.
Now, shout all you wait.
Take the tail of our face. Now the electrodes. Turn the switch.
Oh, put the switch on my
son now. Eternity. Myself a while ago when I was sitting out below. struck the cat through the night.
What did you say?
A man climbing the rocks along the shore.
He was going this way.
We never heard the doorbell yell.
Rest your imagination. Now go on home. Go to bed.
Well, all right, Mr. Rod. I shall get around. Need to find out your own right. Oh, what a sure, cooler night this is, anyway.
Well, good night, Mr. Rod. Good night.
Good night.
Executed somebody all through the years. And suppose he's yelling for the fool I sent to eternity tonight. He's afraid of death. Just like a human. Just like the one I sent away a few hours ago. He didn't want to die. None of them want to die. But he's gone. And once again I wielded the power to take life.
But not the power to give it, Arthur. You don't have that power.
What is that? Who said that?
Who's out there? You back again, Mark?
All right. Mark is well down the cliff by this time. We're alone. Just the two of us.
Who are you?
Where are you?
I'm right here in the room with you.
That's a lie. I know where you are. You're hiding in it. Huh?
Don't
put the
bathroom
on. I'm free. But it's going to be so wet now.
Oh, the
minutes ago, Margot.
Oh, easy now, Lamont. Remember, you're supposed to be dead.
That is so I understand. Let's see how Commissioner Weston reacts to that slight exaggeration. Good evening, Commissioner.
Good evening. What? Who? Hey. Cranston. You're supposed to be dead. You were electrocuted.
Oh, wait. Let me get this straight.
Yeah, I'm supposed to be dead, and I'm very happy to know you cried over my demise.
Now, that's a lie, Cranston.
I never cried in my life. Besides, I knew in my heart that you were...
Say, how did you come back to life?
I mean, we know what you mean.
Now, come on in and shake hands with a real live corpse. And now let me introduce Bruco's distinguished heating expert, John Bartlett.
Thank you, Ken Roberts, and good evening, friends. Some folks, especially you ladies who put a little coal in the fire during the day, are apt to look on the fire as a sort of pancake batter. You said about mixing it thoroughly with the poker. Actually, friends, stirring up the fire with a poker is one of the worst things you can do. Because you mix ashes, live coals, and fresh coal all together, and that forms clinkers. And you know, I'm sure, what grave clinkers can cause. How they choke the fire, prevent coal from burning completely, and damn your furnace great. So, friends, take a tip and lay that poker down. When you want to loosen the fire bed, take the great engine instead. And one more suggestion. Never burn refuse or garbage in your furnace. That also causes clinkers to form. And we've got to avoid clinkers to get the maximum heat out of our coal and make it last longer. I thank you.
The Shadow Program is based on a story copyrighted by Street and Smith Publications. The characters, names, places, and plots are fictitious. Any similarity to persons living or dead is purely coincidental. Again next week, the Shadow will demonstrate that
the weed of crime bears bitter fruit. Crime does not pay. The Shadow knows.
Next week, same time, same station, your friendly Blue Coal dealer brings you another strange and thrilling adventure. In the Shadow's daring battle against the forces of evil. Be sure to listen. This is Ken Roberts saying, keep the home fires burning with Blue Coal. This story produced by the BMW Coal Company.